Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel, MD General Physician. Today we'll be talking on another interesting topic. Very commonly we see those patients in everyday practice. We call obesity and overweight. The two words are different. We'll be talking on both those. You know very well, obesity can lead to lot number of disorders. So we'll be talking on all those aspects. Definition, etiology, pathophysiology, clinical features, investigations, differential diagnosis, treatment and complications. At present, obesity is considered as epidemic and obesity is killing the world. Yes, it is preventable. So there are a lot of different words which are being utilized. Obesity kills, obesity prevention, world is getting fatter, etc. There are a lot of those different words which are being utilized. Even it is called globesity. Global threat waiting. And there are a lot of people who are becoming obese. It is much dangerous than other conditions. In India, we have got 73% of urban Indians are overweight. So almost 3 out of 4 Indians are overweight. And half of urban Indians are obese. So you can see that lot of people are obese and maximum risk age is between 28 to 38. Highest risk of weight gain for the man and woman is between 26 to 38. And you need to lose weight. So we are more than 25. So we need to lose the weight and that is approximately 11 kg. To take them 12 years to gain weight. So if any person wants to gain weight, he will require 12 years to gain weight of 11 kg. So you can imagine how severely this disease is and it is considered as epidemic. 1/5 of male are extremely obese while 1/7 of female are extremely obese. So what is exactly the obesity? Overweight and obesity are defined as an abnormal or excessive fat accumulation that presents in a person and which is a risk to the health. So if the person BMI is 30 or more, it is considered as obese. And if BMI is equal to or more than 25, it is considered as overweight. And BMI is calculated by weight in kilogram divided by height in square meter. This particular criteria is reduced for Indian person. We'll be talking about that also. So obesity is considered as a chronic disease, which is characterized by accumulation of fat. So obesity is a condition when ideal body weight exceeds by 20% of that particular person. So if it is more than 20% of expected ideal body weight of that person with height, age, etc., then we call that as obesity and it has to be because of accumulation of fat. So overweight is excess of body weight and obesity means excess of fat. More than 20% of expected weight of that person. Morbid obesity is obesity with related comorbid conditions. And when it exceeds more than 40 BMI, we call that as severe obesity. Overweight can be because of fat, fluid, muscle mass, bone, tumors, pregnancy, etc. But obesity is because of excess of fat. You can see clearly these two obese. So he's not obese. What are the markers of obesity? You can calculate the obesity by calculating BMI, by waist circumference, waist to height ratio, and weight to height ratio. When you consider weight to height ratio, you are calculating BMI. So these are the different methods by which you can look at the obesity. The most common which is utilized is BMI, where you can calculate by two different formula. One where you utilize weight in kilogram, and another formula where you utilize weight in pound. So when you calculate with the kilogram, it is weight in kilogram divided by height in square meter. While when you calculate in pounds, it is weight in pounds multiplied by 703 divided by height in square inches. So whichever, this is the most common formula which is being utilized, weight in kilogram. And there are ready-made charts which are available. These are ready-made charts. This is in pound and this is height in square inches. So this height you have to calculate, and then what is the weight, and you look at, say my weight is around 150 and my height is 5.6, so it is 24. So this red means my BMI is more, green means safe, red means BMI is, this is underweight, this is healthy weight, sorry, that is healthy weight, this is obesity, overweight, and this is obesity. So red is healthy, this green is overweight, and this yellow means obesity. So you can use these charts. This is height in feet and this is weight in pounds. So you can utilize these charts and accordingly you can calculate. So normal weight between 18 to 25 BMI is considered as normal. Overweight is between 25 to 30. More than 30 is considered as obesity. More than 35 is severe obese. And more than 40 is called morbid obesity, where you start getting comorbid conditions, complications secondary due to obesity. Waist circumference measurements is very, very important. You have to calculate properly by utilizing this all steps, step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4, step 5, step 6, etc. So you have to calculate properly. If you don't follow this step properly, your circumference measurements may be wrong, which can misinterpret obesity or what we call as false interpretation. So follow this particular regularly while measuring the circumference. Waist measurement at the narrowest place and hip measurement at widest place. So you try to measure that properly. Waist measurement should be done at the level of umbilicus and hip measurement should be done at the hip bones area. And by calculating that, you can find out two different types. One we call as the apple type of obesity and pear type of obesity. Or we call gynoid and android. These are the two common words which are being utilized. So hip measurement and waist measurement. And this is pure simple waist measurement. So you divide them into different groups, what we call as underweight, normal, moderate obesity, severe obesity, and very severe obesity. And you can put them into a grade, right from grade 1 to grade 4. Some they utilize up to grade 5 also. And depending upon the type of obesity, you can call central obesity or abdominal obesity or apical type of obesity or android obesity, which is more common in male, while visceral obesity or pear type or gynoid, which is more common in female. So if BMI is between 18 to 23, this is for Indian person, then that is normal. More than 23 is considered as overweight, up to 27.5. And more than 27.5, up to 40 is considered as obese. And more than 40 is considered as morbid obesity. And if BMI is between 15 to 18.4, then that is considered as underweight. And if it is less than 14.9 BMI, it is usually included in starvation. This is the chart which is being followed in India. While this is the chart which is followed abroad, you can see the difference. If BMI is less than 18.5, it is considered as underweight. There is no mention regarding what we call as starvation. Between 18 to 25 is normal, 25 to 30 is overweight, then 30 to 35 obese 1, 35 to 40 obesity 2, then more than 40 severe obesity, and more than 50 is considered as super obesity. These are all the different, and in obesity grading 1, 2, 3, 4. So that is how it is being utilized, and this is most commonly utilized abroad. But in India, we utilize this. So less than 18.5 is underweight, more than 23 is considered as overweight, and more than 27.6 is considered as obesity, while here more than 30 is considered as obesity. So here it is 23 is upper limit of overweight. Sorry, normal weight. And 27.5 is the upper limit of obesity. So this is the thing which is being utilized. In a gynoid variety, usually the obesity is more of visceral and it is a pear shape. While in central obesity, it is called android or abdominal or apical type. So depending upon the where the obesity is there, accordingly it is being labeled. Because there is a little difference between the two. In a gynoid, intra-abdominal and subcutaneous tissue distribution, where if you see, it is more of subcutaneous and less of intra-abdominal. While in android variety, it is more of intra-abdominal adipose tissue. So there is an altered metabolic profile, hypertriglyceridemia, low HDL cholesterol, insulin resistant, glucose intolerance, pro-inflammatory and pro-thrombotic profiles. And it ends up with metabolic syndrome. While in this particular group, there is low triglyceride, normal HDL cholesterol, insulin sensitive, and they will have less chance of cardiovascular risk. So in a gynoid variety, you've got less chance of cardiovascular risk, while in a android variety, there is more chance of cardiovascular risk because they fit with metabolic syndrome. So when you compare male with female, usually in a overweight, in a male, the circumference is more than 102. Here the circumference is more than 88. So that is overweight groups. And depending upon that waist circumference, you can put them into two different groups. For a male, upper limit is 102. This is being reduced in Indian category. Always utilize the BMI chart for finding out BMI. So this is one way, what we have already mentioned before: normal weight, overweight, obese, severe obesity, and morbid obesity. This is starvation. So stage 0, no apparent obesity related risk factors. Stage 1, presence of obesity related to subclinical risk factors, mild physical symptoms. Stage 2, obesity related chronic disorders. Stage 3, established end organ damage. And in stage 4, end stage disability, severe disability. Now if we go through etiology, obesity is multifactorial etiology, which can be physiological, epigenetic, or socioculture. As far as physiological is concerned, it can be environmental, psychological. As far as genetic is concerned, hereditary. Also, endocrine disorders is known to produce obesity, like Cushing syndrome, hypothyroidism. Certain medication can increase your fat and weight. Psychiatric disorders, because good number of drugs which are utilized in psychiatry can increase your body weight, like lithium. And cultural, because certain family, their dietary habits can increase the chance of obesity. And also psychological factors. These are all multifactorial. So let us go through a little bit of that. It is mainly because of more intake of calorie and less utilization of calorie. So there is an imbalance between input and output. The second factor, which is very commonly responsible, is genetic and family history. The third common factor is endocrine, hypothyroidism, Cushing syndrome, PCOS in female, notorious to produce obesity. Drugs like glucocorticoids, antidepressant drugs, anti-epileptic drugs, etc., known to produce obesity. Emotional factor, alcohol consumption, smoking cessation can lead to obesity. Some other factors like pregnancy, lack of sleep, inactive lifestyle, sedentary lifestyle, work schedules, lack of access to healthy food, usually intake of junk foods which is rich in fat, food advertising, lack of neighborhoods, sidewalks, and safe places for recreation. And even if they are present, the person is having sedentary lifestyles. There are some disorders which are genetic, like Prader-Willi, Lawrence Mundbiedel, Down syndrome, Turner syndrome, leptin deficiency, etc. These are some of the disorders which are known to have obesity. Other groups like lifestyle, physical inactivity, eating habits, smoking cessation, age, sex, and race can be responsible for obesity. We already mentioned this: endocrine disorders, hypothyroidism, Cushing, polycystic ovarian syndrome, and hypothalamic insufficiency can also end up with obesity. Drugs like glucocorticoids, sulfonylurea, antidepressants, MAO inhibitors, oral contraceptive pills, and even insulin, because it produces hypoglycemia. Person will have an intake which will be increased, and that will lead to gain in weight. These are the most common factors as far as a dietary habit is concerned. high calorie diet. These are all high calorie diet. And another thing, because of increased facility available, the person do not have an active life. They've got more of sedentary lifestyle and they don't consume this healthy food. The consumption of healthy food is not there. Exercise is not done. So all this leads to obesity. Energy input increases, energy output is decreased. This should be balanced nicely, and if it is balanced, the weight will be maintained. But if there is more of input and less of output, because output is secondary to exercise, basal metabolism and thermogenesis, while input is because of intake, mainly in form of a high calorie diet. So if intake is more, output is less, it will result into weight gain. So usually this is the main factor which is responsible for increased input, and main factor for decreased output is sedentary lifestyle. So high calorie diet is responsible for increased intake, and sedentary lifestyle is responsible for decreased output or energy expenditure, and that will lead to obesity. So very simple, same thing explained, and there are a lot of different types of factors which is acting via central system or peripheral system, and that is responsible for increased intake and decreased output. We Indian, very frequently we eat to live, where intake is equal to expenditure. But there are good number of people in India and abroad where they live to eat, where intake is more than expenditure. And that is the factor which is responsible for obesity. So we Indian loves rich food. You can see all this factor, but we forget this, what we call as a healthy food. So healthy food is not taken, but you eat more of unhealthy food, or we call high calorie diet. And that will end up with, this is same thing shown. This is unhealthy food. This is unhealthy. These are all unhealthy food. And we consume lot of those unhealthy foods. Now, if you consume 3500 calorie, you can gain weight by 1 pound indirectly. So to gain 1 kg, you will require nearly 7000 calorie extra for gaining weight of 1 kg. And if you utilize calorie, you can imagine how much exercise you should do. So if you consume only 100 calorie extra per day, at the end of the year you will gain 5 kg. So if you want to lose 10 kg of body weight, you will require every day to utilize 200 calorie extra by doing an exercise. Then you can lose 10 kg in a year. So if you want to lose 1 kg in 1 month, you will have to utilize 200 calorie every day. Every day. Then you can lose up to 1 kg. And this is very, very important. So think it over. You can imagine this, that if you consume 1 glass of skim milk, it gives almost 100 calorie. A full size banana will give you more than 100 calorie, up to 200 calorie. A 1 tablespoon of butter will give you more than 100 calorie. So if you are consuming 1 glass extra of tea, It is giving you more than 100 calorie because it is containing milk plus sugar. So that will increase your calorie intake. One full cup of tea coffee with full 4 spoon of sugar will give you close to 250 calorie. So one cup extra every day. You can imagine it will increase your body weight by more than 1 kg in 1 month. What we do? We don't do exercise. Exercise is done by a pet dog. And we consume this high calorie diet and we don't do exercise. And that is the main factor responsible for obesity. Same thing is done at home. Someone else does the exercise. We don't do exercise and we consume high calorie. So that is responsible for obesity. This is one simple explanation. There are sensory factors like taste, smell, which will stimulate CNS for appetite and satiety. There will be some cognitive factor which will be responsible for CNS stimulation, and there will be what we call as a hunger signals which will be stimulating CNS and you will eat. So eating will be continued till you get satiety, and that particular satiety, if it is not stimulated, the person will go on eating more and more and then he will gain weight. So there are central signals, there are peripheral signals. So these are peripheral organs which gives the signals, and there are central organs which stimulates. These are the factors which stimulates, these are the factor which inhibits. So depending upon those particular factor, you will have increased appetite or decreased appetite. So this will increase your appetite, this will decrease your appetite and gives rise to satiety. So these signals are central signals and they will be given by external factors, food, etc. Among external factors, emotions, food characteristics, lifestyle behavior, environmental clue, even your taste, smell, etc. And after taking food intake, depending upon the characteristic of the food, you will have, we call, stimulation of peripheral organs like pancreas, intestine, stomach, adipose tissue, adrenal gland, etc., which will give rise to peripheral signals. Some are inhibitory, some are stimulatory. So depending upon that peripheral signals, you will have a stimulation of brain or inhibition of brain. And if it is inhibited and satiety center is stimulated, you will have decreased intake of food. But if central signals stimulates your appetite and satiety center is inhibited, person will have an increased intake of food, which will result into excess of calorie intake and gives rise to what we call as increased body weight gain. So these are put together. There are some central materials or central we can call as stimulatory factors like serotonin, dopamine, catecholamine, endocrine, cannabinoids, peptides, etc., which are acting at the level of hypothalamus. And from GI tract signals, you have got release of GLP-1, GIP, from pancreas, amylin and insulin, from adipose tissue, leptins, even glucagon from pancreas, even fat will release adiponectin, TNF-alpha, vistafatin, etc. Other factors which are released are ghrelins. These are all the different factors. Some will stimulate, some will inhibit. And depending upon that, you will have increased appetite or decreased appetite. So these are all the different things. If you are interested, you can go through in detail at your leisure time. So these are all the slides which you can go through. You can have a pause and you can go through. Very complex mechanism. So, because of overnutrition and lack of physical inactivity, that is lack of physical activity, will give rise to increase calorie intake and decrease utilization, which will produce insulin resistance, hypertension, dyslipidemia, hyperglycemia, hyperinsulinemia, increased inflammatory mediators, impaired fibrinolysis, endothelial dysfunction, hypercoagulability, etc. And that will accelerate atherosclerosis. And because of acceleration of atherosclerosis, coronary artery disease, cerebrovascular stroke, retinal artery involvement, peripheral artery involvement, renal artery involvement, and increased hypercoagulation. And that will finally end up into increased incidence of cerebrovascular stroke, or we call ASCVD, atherosclerotic cardiovascular disorders. Obesity, by and large, can be identified by BMI, by waist circumference, or according to the percentage of body weight fit, body fat. So these are the criteria which are being utilized. We already mentioned regarding BMI. Waist circumference also we have mentioned. This is other country which are following that in a male more than 105, in a female more than 90. As far as India is concerned, this has been cut down to in a male 90 and this is 85. So depending upon that, you label that as obese or non-obese. And percentage of body fat, if it is between 14 to 70% in male and 21 to 24 in female, we call fit. Between 18 to 25 and 25 to 31, we call acceptable. But more than 25% in male and 32% in female is considered as obese. Very well known, this photograph, it is almost shown in all literatures and says weighing 860 pounds, severe obesity. These are all the people you can see clearly, they are all obese. So measurement of obesity can be done by measuring BMI, waist hip ratio, skin fold thickness, biometric impedance, by using ultrasound, by DEXA scan, dual energy X-ray absorptiometry, CT or MRI, air displacement plethysmography, total body electric conduction, and hydrometry. Out of which BMI, waist hip ratio, is most commonly utilized, and another you can utilize is skin fold thickness. And skin fold thickness can be measured by using this instrument where you can measure the skin fold thickness. These are rarely being utilized. So BMI, we have already told you, weight in kilogram divided by height in square meter, or weight in pound multiply by 703 divide by height in square inches. And there are ready-made tables which are available. You can utilize those tables. And waist circumference, we already told you, in male more than 105 and in female more than 90 centimeter is considered as obese. As far as children are concerned, these are some of the complications which can occur in children. Psychosocial, pulmonary, renal, gastrointestinal, musculoskeletal, neurological, cardiovascular, endocrine disorders, and miscellaneous. So there are a lot of different complications which can occur in a childhood obesity, secondary due to childhood obesity. And these are in adult. We'll be talking more of those groups. Pulmonary disease like obstructive sleep apnea, hypoventilation syndrome, abnormal functions, then non-alcoholic fatty liver, which can end up with steatosis, then steatohepatitis, and finally ends with cirrhosis. Chances of gallstone and cholecystitis increases with obesity. As far as female is concerned, abnormal menstrual period, infertility, and polycystic ovarian syndrome. Joint osteoarthritis, skin changes, increased risk of gout, phlebitis, secondary to venostasis, increased chance of malignancy of breast, uterus, cervix, colon, esophagus, pancreas, kidney, prostate, etc. Increased triglyceride will lead to pancreatitis. Secondary to coronary artery involvement, ischemic heart disease, acute coronary syndrome, etc. Metabolic syndrome can end up with diabetes, dyslipidemia, hypertension. Cataract, stroke, and idiopathic cranial hypertension, or we call pseudotumor cerebri. Pseudotumor cerebri. This is quite common. So these are all big list which we consider as a comorbid condition along with hypertension like type 2 diabetes, insulin resistant, hyperinsulinemia, dyslipidemia, hypertension, respiratory disorder like obstructive sleep apnea, hypoventilation syndrome, psychological depression, social complications in cardiovascular, cerebrovascular disease, congestive heart failure, coronary artery disease, thromboembolic phenomena, surgical complications during anesthesia, wound complication, infection, incisional hernia, varicose vein, deep vein thrombosis, carpal tunnel syndrome, fibroadenoma of breast, uterine fibroma, stress urinary incontinence, GI tract disorders like GERD, fatty liver, NAFLD, then that can end into NASH, and finally cirrhosis, gallbladder disease like gallstones, cholecystitis, infertility, pseudotumor cerebri, osteoarthritis, gout, malignancy of good number of organs. All these are comorbid conditions. Because of excessive obesity, person cannot open the eyelid, they can end up with blindness also. Secondary due to fatty infiltration in the eyelid. Person will not be able to open the eye and then finally it will end up into blindness. In an obese individual, you can see a black pigmentation with little tags, skin tags. These are called acanthosis nigricans, which will be seen over the neck in axilla. This is in the neck. This is axilla. Purplish stria will be very frequently seen in a Cushing syndrome. Hirsutism will be seen very frequently in a PCOS. You can see hirsutism. Abnormal hair, or also called as hyperandrogenism. In metabolic syndrome, you will have five things together, that is abdominal obesity, type 2 diabetes, dyslipidemia, hypertension, and microalbuminuria. So, factors contributing insulin resistance, obesity, dyslipidemia, and hypertension. That is very peculiar in case of a metabolic syndrome, or we call as a cardiometabolic syndrome. Now, any person, once you label that person as an obese, mainly clinical picture is more important, and then you have to investigate for risk factors and investigate for effect of obesity on different organs. So weight and BMI calculation, waist circumference, history and physical examination, and then go for laboratory parameters for investigating for risk factors and investigation for effect on obesity. So there is always a question. So these are all the investigations which you can do for finding out insulin resistance. For finding out insulin resistance. So these are some of the investigation and you can label that. So If you do fasting PP, you can find out whether there is an insulin resistance or not. You calculate waist circumference and calculate BMI. So that will be helping you to find out insulin resistance is present or not. Then TG, HDL, LDL. Then hypertension, C-peptide level, insulin level, etc. And even you can have a therapeutic trial like regular exercise and using insulin sensitizer. You can identify whether the insulin resistance is present or not. So after calculating BMI, you must look for risk of cancer, blood pressure, hyperglycemia, hyperlipidemia, liver function, look for obstructive sleep apnea and ischemic heart disease. These are the common investigation which should be done. So again, repeating, look for cancer risk, blood pressure measurements, look for hyperglycemia, fasting postprandial HbA1c, lipids, liver function, and ruling out NAFLD, or we call fatty liver, by different methods. Also observe for obstructive sleep apnea and rule out coronary artery disease. So these are all the different methods we will be going one by one. So in laboratory investigations, fasting PP, lipid profiles, most important. To find out etiology, like endocrine disorders, so cortisol level, sodium, potassium, abdominal ultrasounds or abdominal CT, etc., insulin, C-peptide level, then CT, MRI of head, etc., can be done. So these are some of the different investigations which will be very useful. This is dual energy X-ray absorptometry, which can help you to find out obesity. This is air displacement plethysmography. This is total body electric conductivity. This is hydrometry. As far as differential diagnosis is concerned, you will have to find out genetic etiology, endocrine etiology, and food habits. And try to rule out cardiometabolic syndrome. In management, the most important is lifestyle modification, pharmacotherapy, and surgery. As far as lifestyle modification is concerned, mainly strategy should be there for weight loss therapy by lifestyle food strategy, and then should be added by medication, and if not, then followed by surgery. So surgery should be last. First is lifestyle modification, which includes diet and exercise, followed by pharmacotherapy, and that is followed by surgery. So behavior therapy, diet, exercise, etc., pharmacological treatment along with aerobic exercise, then what we call as a surgical intervention, maybe non-surgical like intragastric balloon and surgical treatment, or we call bariatric surgery. So goal is to reduce and prevent comorbid conditions. First important is diet. Second is physical activity. Third is behavior therapy. And then comes pharmacotherapy, and last is surgery. So any person who is having BMI between 25 to 30, pharmacological therapy should be started. Between 30 to 40, still pharmacology therapy with what we call as diet and exercise should be done. And if it is more than 35 with comorbid conditions, surgery should be advised. So always there is a question, what to do? Person should lose modest weight, and then that weight should be maintained. And prevention of weight regain is the main pillar. And management of obesity-related comorbid conditions should be also treated simultaneously. So it starts with lifestyle intervention, hypocalorie diet, exercise, pharmacotherapy. If that does not work, then only intragastric device, gastric pacemaker, gastric bending, and then you go for surgical intervention like Roux-en bypass, biliopancreatic diversions, and many more. So usually in a diet, low calorie diet, so that you lose 1 to 2 kg in a month. There are some diets, low fat, high carbo, low carbohydrate, high fiber diet is being advised. High fiber, so you should have a healthy diet, good physical activity. These are all the different types of activity. And then comes the drugs which commonly utilize as sibutramine, orlistat, and rimonabant. These are some of the drugs which are very commonly utilized. Other drugs which are not frequently, metformin and alpha glucotidase inhibitor. You should not use thyroxine, amphetamine, and dexfenfluramine. These are not indicated for loss of body weight. As far as bariatric surgery is concerned, there are two types of surgery. We call restrictive surgery and malabsorption surgery. So depending upon that, so if you want to facilitate satiety by reducing capacity of the stomach, unable to consume more than the quantity of food what he was taking, those are called restrictive surgery. So you decrease the size of stomach by different procedure. That is called restrictive surgery. And if you want to decrease absorption surface of the gut, you do a malabsorption surgery. But there is a disadvantage of this surgery, that nutrient products will not be absorbed, and that can result into lot number of different disorders. These surgery are usually permanent procedures. The only method to reassure to lose weight and maintain weight loss is restrictive as well as malabsorption surgery. And when you do malabsorption surgery, it improves glucose tolerance and reverses diabetes. So that should be remembered. By bariatric procedures, you can lose 20 to 40 kg of weight, and you can reduce your BMI by 10 to 15. So a good bariatric procedure should at least lose 20 to 40 kg of weight loss. So malabsorptive surgery and restrictive surgery. Malabsorptive surgery will induce decreased absorption of nutrients by shortening the functional length of small intestine, while restrictive surgery will reduce the storage capacity of a stomach and results into early satiety, leading to decreased calorie intake. This will help in reducing weight, and this will help to reverse diabetes. There are some procedures which are done in restrictive surgery, like adjustable gastric bending. This is most commonly being utilized. Another common is vertical band gastroplasty, that is VBG. This is short form called as AGB. So these are the two common. And then comes sleeve gastrectomy. We'll show you some of the photographs. While malabsorptions are two most common which are being done, Roux-en gastric bypass, short form we call as RGB. R stands for Roux-en and G for gastric, B for bypass. Biliopancreatic diversion, short form it is called BPD. These are malabsorptive procedures so that absorption from small intestine is reduced, and that will help in reversing metabolic conditions, classical like diabetes. So these are purely restrictive procedures, They are restrictive with some amount of malabsorption. These are more of malabsorption with some amount of restriction. And these are purely malabsorptive procedures. We'll show you some of those photographs. Here you can see that food, this is vertical bend, gastroplasty. So you cut off this part of the stomach. So food will come from here. This is the portion of the stomach which will be there. So it will restrict. This is LGP. This is gastric bending. So this will reduce the amount of food which will be kept here. So size of the stomach is reduced. This is intragastric balloon. So these are different procedures by which you are reducing the capacity of the stomach. While in this malabsorptive procedures, what you are doing is the food which comes from here is bypassed directly into the other portion of small intestine so that the absorptive area is reduced. So this food will not come into this part of the stomach or this part of the small intestine. And so absorption will not take place. And this will result into malabsorption. Same thing will happen here. The food will directly go into the distal part of the small intestine. So these are malabsorptive. And that will result into malabsorption of B12. Malabsorption of ADEK and even malabsorption of carbohydrate, fat and proteins. Even calcium and iron will be having disadvantage. So in Rooks and Y, food will come from here into stomach pouch and directly into that small intestine where the malabsorption will take place because this particular loop size is reduced. And that will end up into disadvantage like stomach cutting, stapling, intestinal rerouting required. Dumping syndrome will take place and there will be nutritional deficiency. The advantage is rapid initial weight loss, laparoscopic approach is possible, longer use, and this can be easily done by an expert, and this is for a longer purpose. You can have a diabetic resolution in Rooks and Y surgery, and diabetic resolution can be as high as 81.2%. And in SG, it can be 80.9. Diabetic resolution in bending can be only 60.8. So it is highest in Rooks and Y surgery. And greatest improvement in blood sugar occurs in SG group. There was another procedure which was being done was gastric imbrication. Means laparoscopy wise through a keyhole procedure. It is a reversible procedure which involves only three tiny cuts on abdomen and stomach is folded over itself and stitched. And this will reduce the stomach capacity and will reduce the intake of food. And calorie intake is reduced, person will have a chance of reducing weight. There was another procedure called as a liposuction, or also known as lipoplasty or fat modeling. But liposuction used to create a lot of complications. So this procedure has almost gone out of date. So it was mainly for cosmetic surgery. But it used to give rise to a lot of risk like infection, extended healing time, fat and blood clots, excessive fluid loss and can lead to shock stage, fluid accumulation, friction burns, damage to skin and nerves, damage to vital organs, etc. So this procedure slowly, because of these complications, has gone. the main complications, what happens is lot of comorbid condition. So to find out those comorbid condition, you will have to do some of the investigation. The main cause of obesity is more intake of calorie, and this is what we call is a high calorie food. These are all high calorie food. Complication you can divide into greatly increased risk, moderately increased risk, and slight increased risk. So in slightly increased, chances of cancer like breast cancer, endometrial cancer, colonic cancer, polycystic ovarian syndrome, impaired fertility, fetal defects, low back pain, increased anesthesia risk, etc. Moderate risk, coronary artery, postmenopausal syndrome, hypertension, osteoarthritis, hyperuricemia. But highest risk is of diabetes, gallbladder, dyslipidemia, insulin resistance, sleep apnea, etc. Indirectly we call metabolic syndrome. And this is another slide which shows you a big list of all common diseases which you can get secondary, or we call comorbid condition, like type 2 diabetes, hypertension, ischemic heart disease, metabolic syndrome, hypoventilation syndrome, or we call Pickwickian syndrome, or it is a part of obstructive sleep apnea, joint and spine disorders, psychological, atherosclerosis, dyslipidemia, malignancy, gallstone, PCOS, less chance, less likely, pseudotumor, sleep capital femoral epiphysis, Blount disease, sleep apnea, fatty liver or NFLD, etc. So it gives rise to a lot of different comorbid conditions. So there is a strong message to take home message. Obesity is a common problem. It should be considered as an epidemic. It should be seriously treated. Aggressive treatment is essential for preventing mortality and morbidity. Prevention is better option and has to be started early in the life. Drugs only when total lifestyle medication fails, and surgery is limited to very few people, particularly the person who has got a severe obesity and has got severe comorbid condition. In those conditions, surgery should be indicated. Thanks to all of you for taking time out. I know your time is valuable, and I appreciate you spending some of those time with me. So I hope this lecture will be very helpful to you. And this is one of the most common diseases which you will see in your everyday practice.